Hi everyone, I recently ordered a new e-reader. The biggest decision for me wasn't so much which specific device to buy, but rather which ecosystem to marry into. Will the device I buy tie me to the Kindle ecosystem or the Kobo ecosystem, and which one is better? I owned both in the past and I did quite a bit of research to make up my mind this time around, so I'm sharing what I found with you. When you buy a device like the recently announced Kindle Oasis 3 or the Kindle Paperwhite 4, you essentially receive a fairly locked down device. EPUB files are not supported and you need to convert them to the MOBI format before you're able to read them on your Kindle device. There are programs like Calibre to help you out with the process, but it's still an extra step that you must take and the results are not always perfect. On the plus side, you get access to Amazon's huge catalog of books. Kobo has a giant catalog as well, but it doesn't quite match the Kindle store. Since Kobo offers devices that are more open, however, you'll be able to buy EPUB from anywhere else on the web and read them on your Kobo device. Still, there are definitely some books that are only released for Kindle, so you will very occasionally run into a book that you can't have on Kobo. Kindle also offer seamless integration with Goodreads, since Goodreads is a company that was bought by Amazon, which is nice if you keep track of your library there. To be honest with you, the catalog size is really not a major issue. I think that both catalogs will make most people happy. The bigger difference here is one of philosophy. If you're the kind of person who loves open source, you might dislike Amazon's total control on the device. Now, don't get me wrong, Kobo isn't open source either, but it's certainly more flexible and will read a variety of open formats, including the aforementioned EPUB. It's perhaps worth noting that Kobo books are mostly DRM EPUBs, but nobody forbids you from buying DRM-free EPUB books elsewhere online and then reading them on your Kobo device, if that matters to you. The differences I have outlined so far are true regardless of where you live, but some important pros and cons are very much dependent on your location. If you live in the US, the newest Kindle devices will allow you to play audiobooks from audible.com through Bluetooth headphones, for example. You can also pay a monthly fee to receive access to Kindle Unlimited, which is a collection of over 1 million books available on an all-you-can-read basis. You can think of it as the book equivalent of Netflix, if you will. Many of these titles are indie or quite niche, but you'll also find very popular titles like Harry Potter. If you have Amazon Prime, you'll also get access to Prime Reading, which is a very small collection of Kindle books. To date, there are about 1,000 books there, so don't get too excited about it. But hey, if you're already paying for Amazon Prime, you get them for free, essentially. In the US, you also get to borrow and read on your Kindle ebooks from the public library system through Overdrive. You can also lend and borrow books from other Kindle users for up to 14 days. Outside of the US, the story is quite a bit different. For example, here in Canada, the Kindle catalog is smaller, you can't lend and borrow ebooks from friends, and you can't even borrow library books on your Kindle e-reader. Books tend to be also more expensive here than their US counterpart. But in Canada, we're sort of used to paying a premium for everything except maybe maple syrup and poutine. The newest Kindle devices don't currently support Audible.ca either, so this point is particularly annoying when you consider how much Amazon has been pressuring Canadians to switch from the US side to the Canadian one. Kobo, being originally a Canadian company, fares much better in Canada, of course, by allowing people to borrow ebooks from the public library through Overdrive directly from the devices. This makes the process even smoother than the one experienced by American Kindle users. Integration with the Pocket service is also great, as it allows you to read longer articles you stored in your Pocket account while you were browsing the web on your desktop, for example. The closest thing that Kindle has to this is offered by a third-party service called Instapaper, but in my experience, it's not as seamless. Nevertheless, if you're an American reader, Kindle is a no-brainer. Unless you have ideological reasons against getting an Amazon device, it's pretty much the default choice in America. This is why it's estimated that over 83% of ebook readers in the US are Kindles. Kobo is the second largest player in America, and their partnership with Walmart will only help them out. But Amazon's offering in the US is very strong and hard to beat, to be honest. So unless you take issue with the lack of open formats on the platform or really need a larger device, then Amazon is the choice. Now, Amazon discontinued e-ink devices with screens larger than 7 inches, so that might be a deal breaker for you that makes you more likely to seek out alternatives. But if you're in Canada, the Kindle proposition starts to fall apart. It's a lot less appealing. To me, the lack of support for public libraries in particular is a major blow. If you are an avid reader like I am, the cost of the device sort of becomes irrelevant, because if you need to buy a book every time you read a book, it will end up adding up very quickly. And it's not just me thinking this way. The majority of ebook readers in the hands of Canadians are Kobo devices for a good reason. And that's why I ordered a Kobo Forma instead of a Kindle, which is the equivalent of the Kindle Oasis 3, only it has an 8-inch screen instead of the 7 inches of the Oasis. It doesn't support the Bluetooth for audiobooks, but then again, in Canada, neither does the Oasis. And I tend to listen to audiobooks on my phone while I'm driving or going to the gym. Yes, believe it or not, I go to the gym. One valid alternative would be to buy one of those Chinese Android tablets with e-ink displays, such as the Onyx Books Note. Being Android devices, they will allow you to install both the Kindle and the Kobo apps, as well as OverDrive and any other regular app that you intend to install. This way, you could have the Kindle catalog and the ability to borrow library books, even in Canada. However, these devices tend to be quite a bit more expensive than even the top-of-the-line Kindle or Kobo. They're also not exactly bug-free, and perhaps they lose something by adding more capabilities. If you're looking for an e-reader, less might be more. Part of the beauty of a device like the Kindle or the Kobo lies in their distraction-free nature. The devices are simply not capable of doing much else but reading. With a full-fledged tablet, even with an e-ink screen, the potential to be distracted becomes much more likely. Until next time, I'm Antonio Cangiano and this is Tony on Tech. Feel free to like the video if you found it useful. Feel free to share your thoughts in the comment section below. And since this is a new channel, please help me grow it by subscribing. Thanks again and until next time.